More legal trouble for former Trump associates. The special counsel is recommending up to 24 years in prison for former Trump campaign chairman Paul Manafort for financial crimes. As prosecutors revealed for the first time that they uncovered direct communications between Roger Stone and WikiLeaks, an allegation that raises more questions about how involved the former Trump associate was in getting information about hacked Russian emails. Joining me now is the chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, Congressman Adam Schiff of California. There are so many questions to get to about the Russia investigation, but first I want to ask you about the president's decision to declare a national emergency on the border. You called the decision, quote, plainly unconstitutional, but the law does give the president broad discretion on when to invoke these statutes, and Congress has never really defined what a national emergency is. So why is it unconstitutional?
Well, because this is the first time a president has tried to declare an emergency when Congress explicitly rejected funding for the particular project that the president is advocating. And in saying just the other day that he didn't really need to do this, he just wanted to do it because it would help things go faster, he's pretty much daring the court to strike this down. So it's hard to imagine a poor case, but I'll say this, Dana, it is going to be a real test for my GOP colleagues in Congress and their devotion to the institution. If we give away, if we surrender the power of the purse, which is our most important power, there will be little check and no balance left. It'll not be a separation of powers anymore, just a separation of parties. So this is going to be a moment of truth for my GOP colleagues.
Well, and you're referring, of course, to what the House is likely to do and later the Senate, which is a joint resolution to terminate the president's national emergency. But let me ask you about potentially going a step further, because that would be hard to get a veto-proof majority on in both chambers. Do you think that Congress should actually change the law so that the president can no longer declare a national emergency without the support of Congress?
Well, there are reasons why a president should have an ability to declare an emergency that is under a real emergency. That's plainly not the case here. And the risk that the president takes, the risk to future presidencies, is that we limit the president's power to act when it really is necessary, when it is not practical to bring the Congress into session on a moment's notice. But this president doesn't care about future presidents. He only cares about himself. And in this case, he only cares about placating his conservative critics.
Let's talk about the Mueller investigation. We learned on Friday that the special counsel obtained evidence of Roger Stone's direct communication with WikiLeaks, which he had said before didn't exist. And we also know that Stone was coordinating with a senior Trump campaign official, and those emails were hacked by the Russians. So what does that tell you?
Well, it tells me that, as we have seen in other cases that the special counsel has brought, the full story is not in the indictment, that it is very possible that the best evidence is yet to come, that, in fact, here there were search warrants executed on multiple accounts of these Russian hackers that reveal communications between Roger Stone and WikiLeaks, and essentially directly with the GRU and Roger Stone, because the GRU was acting with the persona Guccifer II. The substance of those communications can be very telling. It may go to what Roger Stone was trying to find out. It may go to whether he was communicating that information to people back in the White House. It could be very revealing, and we'll just have to wait to find out.
This week, the chair, your counterpart in the Senate, the Republican chair of the Intelligence Committee, Richard Burr, said that his committee has found nothing to suggest collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia. You said, quote, that's not our view in the House. But, you know, Burr hasn't exactly been a rabid partisan on this until the last couple of weeks. He's been working very closely with the Democrats. So why do you think he's wrong?
Well, it's not just that I think he's wrong. Mark Warner, the vice chair of the Intel Committee in the Senate, also disagrees with that assessment. But look, you can see evidence in plain sight on the issue of collusion, pretty compelling evidence. Now, there's a difference between seeing evidence of collusion and being able to prove a criminal conspiracy beyond a reasonable doubt. But Chairman Burr must have a different word for it, because when you look, for example, at the emails to set up the meeting in Trump Tower, it was offered to the Trump campaign, to the president's own son, dirt on Hillary Clinton as part of what was described as the Russian government's effort to help Donald Trump in the campaign. And the response from the campaign was, we would love to have the help. Now, that's an offer of help. That's an acceptance of help. There's an overt act in the Trump Tower in furtherance of that. And, of course, that's not even contemplating the discussions with George Papadopoulos or the information about the efforts that Mike Flynn made to work with the Russian ambassador secretly to undermine sanctions and then lie about that. All of this is evidence of collusion. And you either have to look the other way to say it isn't, or you have to have a different word for it, because it is a corrupt dealing with a foreign adversary during a campaign. But again, it will be up to Mueller to determine whether that amounts to criminal conspiracy.
Well, on that note, we expect at some point, maybe soon, maybe not, the findings of the Mueller investigation to finally be completed. If he finds that there was no direct collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia, will you accept that?
Well, we're going to have to do our own investigation, and we are. We'll certainly be very interested to learn what Bob Mueller finds. We may have to fight to get that information. Bill Barr has not been willing to commit to provide that report either to the Congress or to the American people. We're going to need to see it. The American people are going to need to see it. We may also need to see the evidence behind that report. There may be, for example, evidence of collusion or conspiracy that is clear and convincing, but not proof beyond a reasonable doubt. The American people are entitled to know if there's evidence of a conspiracy between either the president or the president's campaign and a foreign adversary. At the end of the day, the most important thing for the American people to know is whether the president is somehow compromised, whether there's leverage that the Russians could use over the president. And if the Russians are in a position to expose wrongdoing by the president or his campaign, that's compromising.
You're talking about transparency, but I guess the question is, in terms of what the substance of his findings are, Robert Mueller, will you, given the fact that he has had such an extensive investigation, will you accept the findings separate from the investigation that you're doing?
You know, I will certainly accept them in this way, Dana. I have great confidence in the special counsel. And if the special counsel represents that he has investigated and not been interfered with and not been able to make a criminal case, then I will believe that he is operating in good faith.
Federal prosecutors are still considering whether to bring charges against former FBI Deputy Director Andrew McCabe after he allegedly lied to investigators about authorizing leaks to the media. Now, we've seen at least five Trump associates indicted for just that, lying to investigators. Do you think McCabe should be prosecuted for doing the same thing?
Well, the Justice Department received a referral from the Inspector General. I think they need to study that and the evidence, and they need to make an objective determination about it. I think he should be held to the same standard as anyone else that the Justice Department has looked at in this investigation or any other.
A little bit of 2020 politics before I let you go. The governor of your state, Gavin Newsom, endorsed California Senator Kamala Harris in the Democratic primary for 2020. He joined four of your fellow California representatives in Congress. So what about you? Are you going to endorse Senator Harris for president?
I haven't made any decisions in the presidential race yet. It's still very early. But I have to say, I've been very impressed with Kamala Harris as a senator. And I've been extremely impressed with her as a candidate for president. In a rare bout of truthfulness by President Trump, he acknowledged what a superb rollout she's had. And I think we can already compare her favorably with some of the other candidates this early, but I'm not ready to make a decision.